My name is Maurice de Beijer, and I'd like to talk to you about event sourcing your Angular applications. Now, I've been in this business for like 25 years, been independent for 20 years, and all those years I've basically had a mission. I've been trying to make better applications. And of course, better is somewhat a subjective term, but it turns out that in average, there's still a lot of room for improvement. We're doing a pretty good job, and for the most part, I pretty like the stack I'm working with, Angular on the front end, document databases on the back end. Typically, I use .NET as my middle tier, but we're not quite there yet. And one of the problems I've been working on the last years is solving the way we store data. Now, one of the things I've done, I've taken the Richardson maturity model, which is basically used to describe the maturity of REST services, and kind of adapted it to data storage. So right at the bottom, there is just dumping your data to disk, just taking whatever data structure you have, maybe serializing it to JSON or some proprietary format, and working with that. And it goes up several levels all the way up to event sourcing. So let's start at the bottom to give us some perspective. Using data dumps or structured storage. I'm kind of lumping these together, although the backend is quite different. Whether you use a database or just dumping it in a file is quite different. But as far as the application, the front end is concerned, there isn't really that much of a difference. So in this scenario, we're just storing data as is. We're only storing the current state. We've got really no sense of how we got to where we are. Maybe we've got some system with an audit log, maybe we don't. If we've got an audit log, hopefully it will tell us a bit about how we got to the state we are. But quite often, that's either in a way you can't use it, like for instance with SQL Server or Oracle, or it isn't there at all. And it doesn't really matter how you store your data. Whether you use SQL Server, MySQL, Oracle, relational database like that, you use a NoSQL database like Mongo, Redis, RavenDB, one of the many there. It really boils down to, we've got state, we load the state from the database into our front end, we modify that state and send the state back as is. So our architecture looks something like this. We've got the browser, it makes a request to our server. I want, for instance, a movie. The middle layer, the server, goes to the database, retrieves that movie resource, sends it back to the browser. The user starts editing it, makes changes to it. The browser then takes that whole movie resource, sends it back to the server, and the server says, well, okay, I'll store it in the database. Maybe it does a little validation, but the server doesn't really do a lot with it. It's basically just a gateway passing through. And in a typical Angular application, this happens quite a lot. And that's in part due to dollar resource. Dollar resource is really awesome, really cool, makes it really easy to do your data access. But it kind of suggests you've got this RESTful endpoint there, and you do a get to load a resource, you do a put to update that existing resource, or maybe a post, do a delete to delete it, but it's really cruddy, and we're sending the complete resource back. And that kind of sounds like I'm suggesting that dollar resource is bad and an anti-pattern, but it's not. It's really good, it's really useful, but it's designed for a relatively simple case, and not every application really is that simple. But if your application is, for instance, you've got a typical to-do application where it's single user or mostly single user, you're storing relatively simple items and you don't really care about how it got there. I've got a bunch of things to do. I'll check them off when they're done. When I created them, when I checked them, doesn't really matter. Then using dollar resource and using simple CRUD logic is perfectly fine. But there are lots of applications where this is not so fine. For instance, if you've got a banking application, you've got an account there, you've got an account balance. Now, every time you make a payment somewhere or you deposit some money, the bank is not going to load up your account resource, change the amount there, your balance, and save that back. If they did, it would be incredibly brittle. Suppose there is a multi-user conflict. two transactions occur at the same time, they load the same resource, change it, save it back. Concurrency issue. Well, we could start handling that, but we need lots of extra logic around that and managing that. So in cases like that, you really don't want to do this. So the next step up is to use CQRS. So in the case of CQRS, we're going to split the way we retrieve data and the way we update it. So CQRS stands for command and query segregation. The querying part loads resources, just like we did before. But instead of making changes to those resources and sending them back as is, we're going to send commands to the server. Commands basically tell the server what changes you made. Like, I've deposited some money, so there will be a command saying, deposit 10 euros on account 123. The server then goes, loads the resource, makes a change in a fashion that's not multi-user contentious, etc., and goes and saves it, and next time you request that resource, it's updated. So the typical architecture looks something like this. We've still got the browser, and it still does requests to get resources. That's the top side, the query side. So it's going to request our accounts, and there is a balance property there, and we can see the balance. Now, when the deposit is made, we use the bottom side, the command. We send the command and updates the database. So there is a lot more intention here about what we're doing. But there is still one big problem. We're still storing only the current state. Our balance is 10 euros. How did we get there? Well, don't really know. Was there an error somewhere in the program which resulted in the wrong balance? Well, maybe there was. So what's the correct balance? Don't know. We've only got the current. So it's still somewhat limited. Now, in a CQRS system, commands are vitally important. Commands are all about what we do. Deposit money, withdraw money, change name, any such thing. Basically, when you think of commands and you read the command name to a business person, he should understand what the command does. So a command is never like replace accounts or update accounts. There's no business meaning there. It's deposit money, withdraw money, pay check, open new accounts, close accounts, those kind of things. But we're still updating current state, so it's kind of like, we've got this state, how did we get here? We've got this nice arch in France, how did it get to be that state? I don't know. It's nice, it's beautiful, but was that hole there always, and was that pillar built up around the hole, or was there a solid rock there, and was the hole slowly eroded out of it? We can't really tell. All we know is what the current state is. And that's one of the big things event sourcing is trying to solve. So with event sourcing, we're no longer going to store just the current state. We're going to store events leading up to the current state. So storing events is not a new thing. In fact, it predates computers by many, many centuries. Back in the old days when the king had his land and a bunch of cows, for instance, his bookkeepers would keep track of how many cows he had. Well, if he sold a cow and he bought a couple of others, they wouldn't rub out the number of cows he owned. They would add from, okay, sold one cow, purchased two, one died somewhere, three young calves were born. And they would basically tally that up, and after some time, they'd calculate a new total amount of cows he had. Bookkeeping does this a lot. If you go into accountancy systems, bookkeeping, everything is done through a transaction ledger. The balance is not one fixed number. The balance is a sum of all the transactions there. And event sourcing basically goes back to that system and says, well, instead of storing the current state, we're going to store all the events leading up to this state. And when you need to know the state, we'll just sum up all those events and present you with the current state. In functional terms, that's called a left fault. The current state is the left fault of all the events leading up to that current state. So that gives us a perfect audit trail. We know exactly how we got somewhere. We know exactly what happened, everything that led to, up to it. So the relation between commands and events are pretty strong. Commands are your intention to do something. Events are the result of that being done. Think of events as things in history. Something happened. The command is, okay, I want something to happen. The event is the end result of that. Now, you might not like the result. There's things happened in history which we don't like, but that doesn't change the fact that they did. Commands might be issued you don't like. You might say, well, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to reject the command. So if you do validation, you do it at the command level. But after that's passed and you've decided to do what you do, then we're at the level where we've actually got an event. Now, events are never changed. Events are kind of written in stone. You don't go in and change them. We might interpret them differently at some later point in time, but they don't ever change. We just keep on appending. So it's an append, read only, or append only and read only model, not a read-write model. So the architecture looks pretty simple to command and query segregation. We've still got our query service, we've still got our command service, but instead of storing the current state, we now have two databases. We've got one database with a long list of events, everything which ever happened in the system, and we've got another database which basically creates our read model. Now, in order to do normal business-like screens, we need a read model. Reading events and denorm or calculating the current state every time is expensive. Doing a query, say, for all customers who have a balance larger than 1,000 euros would mean getting all the customers' events from the event store, calculating all their current balances, and then deciding which customers meet the criteria. That's an expensive query. So what happens usually in practice, it's not per se required, but it's almost always the case, we project things out into a read model. So we've got this projection service, which basically looks at all the events being added to the event database. It projects them out in whatever shape needed into a projection database, which could be a relational database, it could be a document database, but it's something which is optimized for reading. The query side reads those and serves up all the data needed for the front end. This gives us some benefits. If you look at this, you can see, well, the projection database is never actually updated directly by the customer. Customer sends commands. All that does is inject something into the event database. After that, the command's basically done. Event stored, history is written, we know what happened. Somewhere in the background, our projection service projects those out into a read model. Now, the fact that that happens in the background means that it's not performance critical anymore. Of course, it has to happen in a reasonable amount of time, but as long as it's reasonable, it's perfectly fine. Which also means that we don't have to normalize our projection database. Most databases are designed for write speed. We want to make fast updates, which is very nice, but what happens most of the time, we're not updating, we're reading. Well, here, because it's all outside of the direct loop, feedback loop from an end user perspective, we can basically say, well, we can denormalize our projection database and optimize it for reading instead of writing. So the events, append only, never changed. Well, almost never. There are some occasions when you want to change events, but basically you should think of events as read-only and never changed. Just keep on writing to them. Projections happen behind the scene. Take the event and turn it into whatever is optimal for your application for reading. And it's perfectly fine to project some events into multiple things. Suppose you've got a movie database, IMDb, and people can rate movies. And it's kind of nice, you go to a movie, you see the rating from, okay, the current rating of this movie is an 8.0. And people can rate it, etc., so that changes. Now the boss comes in and says, well, that's kind of nice, but I kind of want to know how that rating changed over time. Well, we've got all the events that lead up to the current rating, and if we know when those occurred, we can basically say, well, okay, now we project it out into a different structure where we rate by day, and we can easily create a new screen showing a graph of how this same rating changed over time. Of course, if you'd done it the old way, where you just sort the current state, that would be kind of, nice request. I'm afraid that's not going to work anytime soon. But it will work in a year from now. We'll start capturing the data now. With an event sourcing system, it's a matter of changing your projections, and maybe tomorrow you're good to go and you can project everything out. Now, there is one problem with projections. I mentioned the fact that a command writes things into the event store, if validated, and then is done. But the projection service runs behind the scenes and updates the actual read model. Now, it's not going to take long. In most cases, that might be maybe a tenth of a second slower, but there is a slight delay there. So if a customer actually says, well, I'll deposit some money, he gets an OK status back, money deposited, and then he looks at his balance and hasn't changed. Where did my money go? Did it go to some other one's account? Was there a bug there? Did some bank employee buy a new Porsche with my money? Something like that. If he'd wait a second and then refresh the screen, he would show the update, but it isn't there immediately. So that's a little complexity we have to start dealing with, eventual consistency. The data is there, it will be updated, but not immediately. For the most part, that's no problem. If I rate a movie and I don't immediately see my own rating, well, it might have been rated 8, I rated it 10, so maybe it's 8.1 now. I can't really tell, so it's not much of an issue. But that with that bank account, it's a bit of an issue. People would like to see their deposit. So there are a couple of ways you can go around fixing them. The simple thing is just block, maybe show the user some blocking UI message box saying, we've accepted your deposit and we're busy processing it. And by the time he's actually clicked on that message to make it disappear, it's updated and you're good to go. Works, but not really user-friendly. A better approach is do either one of two things. You can use push notifications, something like socket.io, for instance, where the projection site actually pushes information to the client saying, well, these bank accounts have been updated, and if you're interested, here's the current balance. The other way, which is very common, is to fake things on the client. On the client, you know, well, you deposited some money, so we know that if that command's accepted, your balance will change by this amount. So instead of actually asking the backend for the current balance, we'll just fake it and update it on the client. And that's an approach taken by lots of sites. If you're on Facebook, you create a Facebook post, Facebook sends that to the server, and as soon as they get a 200 OK status back from their HTTP backend, they will inject it into your timeline on the frontend. If you now refresh the browser, you've actually got a small chance that your post is gone again. If you refresh a couple of times, it will reappear. But they're kind of faking on the frontend what's happening on the backend. So event sourcing is really nice, but it's also sort of a powerful constructs, and you don't want to overdo it. If you're doing a to-do application, don't go and event source it. If you're doing a banking application and you need that audit trail and to be able to prove that you're right and maybe change your projection model on the fly, by all means use event sourcing. But even there, don't use it for everything. You'll have a table, or most likely at least, you'll have a table with countries in the world, so a client can pick the country they live in. Does that change frequently? No. It changes occasionally. Do you really care about tracking changes there? No. Just store that in a normal CRUD fashion. It's low maintenance, low risk, no problem. But account data, by all means, go and event source that. Now, I've got a bit of a demo application. If you download the slides, in the notes of the slides are links to my demo application and several other resources. And of course, I'm using Angular on the front end. Perfect for all sorts of business applications, so I really love using it. For event sourcing, I'm using a product called GetEventSource. It's an open source product written by Greg Young, and it's really good at storing events and projecting them out again. You write the projection software, but it's a really good database for that. It's open source, so easy to get started with. And there are lots of client libraries you can use, whether it's Node or .NET or something else. Good to go. You need to store your projections somewhere. Now, projections are kind of temporal. You can kind of lose them because you've got all the events, so you can rebuild them. So I'm using Redis. In-memory object database, you can kind of store things and retrieve them really fast, but it only persists to disk occasionally after a few thousand writes. But if it crashes and I have to restart, it's kind of like, well, I just look how far the projections are and I do the last few thousand. Doesn't take long. So it's a really nice document store for projections. I'm using ASP.NET as my middle tier, but basically you can use whatever you like. It's just because I'm a .NET developer by trade that I use ASP.NET. Node, Java, whatever you prefer, Ruby. But be careful, it's work in progress. It's a demo application which I make in my spare time. I'm doing this paid for customers in real time, but I can't really publish those on the internet. So it's by no means finished, by no means complete. I'm doing it little by little. So with that, I'd like to thank you. Remember, there are a whole bunch of notes and links to other things in the slides. So if you want to know more, download the slides, take a look at the notes section and see all the stuff there. If there are any questions, I'm available for the rest of the day. I'll be here all day at the conference, or you can come up. I don't think we've got time for questions right now, but just come up to me afterwards. Thank you.